Jesus, we give you praise this afternoon. We worship you. We thank you for your goodness to us, your great love that you've given us. We recognize you as the King and the ruler, the Lord of our life. We bless you and give you praise this evening. Ah, what great love he has for us. On this time of year, always reminds us of it. Lord, bless you. You may be seated. I'm not going to be here Sunday, so let me just say Merry Christmas to all of you right now. I love this time of year. I love that family feeling, that love, the body of Christ. You feel that all year round, but especially at Christmas. Luke chapter 2, verse 10 through 11 says, "And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord." We're commemorating that time when the Savior came to save you, and he came to save me, he gave us fresh life. Reverend Phillips Brooks, you've probably never heard him speak before because he ministered in the 1800s. But 1865, I'm just guessing with that. 1865, he took a trip to the Holy Land, and he went to the Church of the Nativity in Bethlehem. On Christmas Eve, he participated in a service. And he was so moved by that, it was still impacting him 3 years later. And as he prepared for the Sunday message in a church he pastored in Philadelphia, his children was going to sing. The Sunday school children was going to put on a special program like we did last week. And so he started to write a song. And he asked his organist, Lewis Redner, if he would compose the music that would go along with it. And so it came to be that song, "O Little Town of Bethlehem." It's been a favorite ever since then. Just want to read one of those verses to you. "O little town of Bethlehem, how still we see thee lie. Above thy deep and dreamless sleep, the silent stars go by. Yet in thy dark street shineth the everlasting light." Oh, brothers and sisters, we know that light of the world. It may be a dark situation you're facing. You may not feel all the joy of Christmas, but you know the light of the world. The one who came into this world to create hope and to give us life. The light of Christ met all of our fears, replaced them with hope and with faith. With the miraculous gift of the Holy Ghost. He even called it the Great Comforter. He was coming to be with us. And at this time of year, we can recognize and thank him for that gift he gave us. What a comfort it is to know Jesus. To rest in his presence no matter what the situation is, I have a friend in Jesus. Amen. For ushers will come and receive the tithe and offering. Remind you that Sunday we're just going to have one service. It's at 10 a.m. So I encourage you to end up participating in that. It is the Lord's birthday. It's not going to be a long service. We're going to sing some Christmas carols. You're going to have a special, special pianist. We're going to have a wonderful time together. Lord bless you. Jesus, we thank you for your goodness to us. Thank you for this time of celebration around your birth, remembering you, the whole world remembering you, but your church specifically. We give you honor and we give you glory this evening. We ask your anointing upon the remainder of the service, upon the tithe and offering, as we give it to you with joy. In Jesus' name, amen. Jesus, you're so worthy of all of our praise. We worship you together. We give you glory. We give you thanks for your blessings, your glory, and thanks for your peace, for your anointing upon this sanctuary. I love the presence of the Lord. I love being with you in the presence of the Lord. Something about family being together, there's strength in that. Bishop mentioned it. The first time I heard it was this last year. That Jesus' relationship to us is as the Father to the Son, but jointly to the bride of Christ, the church, it's as the bride, much more intimate relationship. And that has just stuck with me ever since. I love being in church with you. Lord, bless you. Enjoy fellowshipping together, and we'll hear the word in just a few minutes.
language, Jesus first, yourself last, and others in between. That is the only principle that will guard you against selfishness and covetousness and all of those things that rob us of the joy of the Lord. Now, I'm talking about the same text that we used last week, Nehemiah 8 and 10, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. Unhappy Christians are very weak in their faith, and they're dissatisfied with themselves, they're dissatisfied with God, they're dissatisfied with me, they're dissatisfied with you. That's just the way it is. But the joy of the Lord is our strength. We talked last week about the prolific supply of Bibles that's in America. According to a poll, 90% of American homes own a Bible, and the average home has at least three. And if all the Bibles had stacked in America were stacked one upon the other, it'd be a tower that would be 1,000 times taller than Mount Everest, 29 million feet tall. With all the prolific scriptures abounding about our nation, you take a look at the sad estate of our nation and you realize that it's not the absence of the Word of God, but it is the famine for the hearing of the Word of God. Hello? It's all around us. But the Bible says in Amos 8 and 11, "Behold, the days come, saith the Lord God, that I will send a famine in the land, not a famine of bread nor thirst of water, but of hearing." Everybody say hearing. Hearing. See, you haven't heard the Word of God until you receive it into your heart and act upon it. It's just a sound that goes through your ear. It means nothing. But if you will hear it, like the dry bones that had no ears heard it, you can live. If you let it enter into your heart. Sovereign God could send a famine, not of food, but of the hearing of the word of the Lord. That is a word of explanation. Oh, I want to know why. A word of forgiveness, a word of hope. And God said that when their desperation drove them to the point that they finally would seek the Lord, they would run from the east to the west, from the north to the south, and the Lord would not be able to be found because it would be too late. Aren't you grateful that you sought the Lord when you heard the word? Aren't you glad it was not a famine for the hearing on your part? Not a famine of the speaking, but a famine on the hearing. So it's not the absence, but it's the ignorance of Scripture that is so prevalent in our world today. That's why it says, hear the word of the Lord and live. We talked about the background material from Nehemiah and said that Ezra and Nehemiah put the word of God first. And what happened in Jerusalem from that point on was a byproduct of the people's response to the scripture. God uses his word to cleanse, to revive, and to rejoice our hearts. The wall is finished. The gates are in place. Watchers are upon the walls. Guards are set. They take a census. They find out, or a census, and find out how many people is in Jerusalem. Then they discover the need for teaching the Word of God. The people come for at least 5, maybe 6 days. They came at 6 a.m. and they stood from 6 till 12 listening to the Word of the Lord being read. And the Bible said there was great joy whenever they began to grasp the understanding of the word of the Lord. It says there was very great gladness, rejoicing, joy. One translator says it was a terrific day. It was a day of great joy. Jesus told his disciples in John 15 and 11, after he's ministering to them about the vine, the branches, the fruit, etc., etc., he says, "These things I have spoken unto you, that my joy might remain in you, and that your joy might be full." You cannot, I cannot, we cannot have the joy of God abiding in us if the Word of God isn't abiding in us. The very first thing that mankind failed in is when he knew God, he failed to acknowledge him as God. Didn't glorify him as God. God says to Adam in the garden, "Of that tree, That's the only tree in the garden that was forbidden. But of that tree, do not partake thereof. And then he tells him why. For the day that you do, you're going to surely die. Now, if we can't listen to righteous instruction in the garden, how much more do we have trouble listening to it today in the sin nature? There was no sin nature. Adam was made perfect in the presence and likeness of God, but he could not honor God. Number one, when God gave him a gift, beware of how you treat the gifts God gives you. They can become an idol to take the place of God himself. God gave him a beautiful gift, a precious helpmate, and she was deceived, and she offered to him. Instead of saying, "Oh no, Eve," instead of taking his position of leadership and headship, he chose to side with her and sin with her, knowing it was contrary to the word of God. So number one, he did not acknowledge God as God, and neither were they thankful for the trees that they had other than that. So God's word has to abide in us if his joy is going to abide in us. The next time we hear from God, they hear the voice of God in the garden. The voice is saying, "Adam, where are you?" When Adam replies after a while, you know, after a while you have to realize you can't hide from God. He's only given you an opportunity to come forth. But he replied, "I was naked. I was afraid. I hid myself." And the Lord said, "Who told you you were naked?" And we see the Lord's disposition, his attitude of mercy mixed with wrath, because he pronounced judgment and then ripped the skins off of an innocent lamb and covered them with the blood. So Jesus said, "My joy will remain in you because I've given you this word. You receive it." Now that's the strength of our faith. That's the strength of our faithfulness. If we do not have joy in the Lord, we will not have faith in the Lord. It's amazing to me that when life treats people bad, even God's people, the first thing they want to do is blame God for it. Hello? Why did you let, if I were God, hello? The very first thing. So the joy of the Lord is the strength of our faith. It is the strength of our faithfulness, because people who are not joyful in the Lord are not tend to be faithful to the Lord. Their fidelity is very low, and it's the strength of our salvation. The people agreed with Nehemiah and Ezra to make a covenant. It had four vows. Number one, avoid intermarriage with non-Israelites. Number two, avoid profaning the Sabbath. Number three, maintain the temple. And number four, to tithe faithfully. Okay? Hearing, believing, obeying God's word brought restoration. It pointed the people to their sin. It pointed them to their failings. It pointed them to their shortcomings. It led them to repentance. It brought them to surrender and obedience and worship. And the word gave them great joy. How many believe it'll do the same for us today? Hello? The word enables us to see things as they really are. Go your way, he said. Celebrate, sin portions. But don't be sorrowful. Do not grieve for this is a holy day, and the joy of the Lord is your strength. As Christians, we are to be people of the book. True Christians are. I keep hearing this sign. I see the sign, and I'm appreciative of the sign that says people of the name. But we need to also be people of the word. Hello? People of the book. Because man shall not live by bread alone, but by the name of God? No, every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God, because it's the word that brings us the revelation of the name of God. Hello? And it's the word that brings us the revelation of where we are, how we got here, and how we're going to get out. And the word brings us a joy. The New Testament church was born to demonstrate devotion. We are not to take Hollywood, nor Broadway, nor Wall Street, or anyone else, or anything else of this world, as our pattern and illustration. We are to demonstrate devotion. Not devotion to style and fashion and what's in vogue today. Not devotion to the almighty dollar. but we are to have a devotion, if you please, to that righteousness, which is the result of the revelation of Holy Word and the Holy Ghost. Aren't you grateful that God's Word can be opened up to you and you can find the righteousness of God? The anointing of the Spirit can be filled, can fill you, and you can know the joy of the Lord? That's why we're here. That's why you're in this church, to demonstrate righteousness. That's not just to do right, but that's to live right, to think right, to speak right, to be right. So when we stray from loving it, reading, obeying the Word of God, we lose the joy of the Lord. It's just that simple. It doesn't matter why you stay from the table. You stay away long enough, you'll starve. Hello? I don't know if anybody else is like me, but I could blame it on a blood condition, but I won't. It's just me. When I'm hungry right now. And if I don't get fed shortly, I tend to get cranky. I'm the only one here, I know. I know I'm the only guy that's there. But I'm here to tell you, when you don't eat the Word of the Lord, you can go stuff yourself with Twinkies. You can go stuff yourself with entertainment. You can go, come on, how many hearing what I'm saying? You can stuff yourself, and there's a lot of stuff out here to stuff ourselves with, but you just get cranky. Amen. But if you feed on the Word of the Lord, the key to joy is obedience, love, joy, and peace. We went through the progression of the fruit of the Spirit last week. It starts with love, because God is love. And that love is shed abroad in our heart by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us, according to Romans chapter 5 and verse 5. God did not give us the spirit of fear, but the spirit of love and of power and of a sound mind, according to 2 Timothy chapter 1, I believe about verse 6. And so it begins with love. We talked about the fruit of the Spirit. And if you'll just listen to me, they'll get you your papers. You've got another lesson on the backside of that, so don't jump ahead of me, okay? Thank you for your attention. You're so pretty. Of course, I got wrong glasses on to know whether you're pretty or not. I got my computer glasses on. I thought I might have to use my computer tonight. But nevertheless, okay, when you stay away from the Word of the Lord, regardless of what you fill the vacuum with, you'll get cranky. You'll lose the joy of the Lord. Because the key of joy is, first of all, the love of God shed abroad in our heart, obedience to the Word of God, obedience in love, and it's love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. And it's in season 24/7, 365 a year. Okay? Moving right along. According to your faith, so be it, was the principle Jesus used to two blind men. They believed. He touched them. They could see. As your joy, so is your strength. That's what Nehemiah said. So whatever happens today, don't let it cause you grief. Don't allow yourself to take a nosedive. Look up. On the bottom, you can still look up. Hello? This is a holy day. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will. Somebody help me. I will. Not I feel. I will. Folks, if anything else could go bad today, it didn't show up. Everything I've touched today has gone backwards. Everything. I won't even elaborate on that. But you are as strong in the Lord as your joy in the Lord. Amen? We talked about the King James Version Bible, 31 plus thousand verses, 165 times the word joy mentioned. Not one time are we told to pursue it. We're told to seek the Lord, seek peace, pursue it, follow after righteousness, follow after things that make for peace and that edify each other. We're told to follow after the love of God and the love of God for others. We're told to desire spiritual gifts. We're told to follow after God's plan for our life. Paul said in Philippians 3 and 12, I follow after, if that I may apprehend, that for which I am apprehended of Christ Jesus. The New International Version says, I press on to take hold of that for which Christ took hold of me. How many believe God's got a purpose for your life? He didn't just tap you out of nothing. He had a purpose. He's got a plan. The Living Bible says, I keep working toward that day when I will finally be all that Christ saved me for and wants me to be. That's the revelation of joy. It's not a goal that we can seek after. It's the result of seeking after the Lord. loving the Lord, joyfully submitting to a sovereign God, seeking with all that is in you, your heart, soul, mind, and strength, to please the Lord in all things that you think, you say, you do, in all of your desires, your dreams, your ambitions, that you might hear him one day. How many of you want to hear the Lord one day say, well done, thou good and faithful. If all liars are going to have their part in the lake of fire, don't expect the Lord to lie to you. We are only going to hear him say, well done, if we spend a lifetime seeking him, entertaining his presence, letting his word speak into us and his spirit mold us. The joy. Follow after righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, meekness. Go your way, celebrate, send portions to those for whom it was not even prepared. Do not grieve, though, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. Now, there is a fulfillment of the natural desires of the flesh. There's a physical pleasure. There's a delight, an enjoyment, which is tied to our senses. It's sensual and indulges and satisfies the appetites of the flesh. It's there. It's real. Hello? When it's hot, I like to have air conditioner. Hello? I can get real joyful about that. And when it's cold, bless your heart, I like heat. There's nothing wrong with that until that which is natural takes the place of that which comes only supernatural. When that which of earth is earthly and temporal takes the place of that which is eternal. Those who live in the flesh see their indulgence of the flesh as joy. Hello? They want to indulge themselves and they get the ha-ha pleasure, the joy, the ecstasy. And they seek that indulges their flesh as the goal of their life, only in the end to be miserable, wretched, and heartbroken. Can't convince them before then unless the Lord can deal with their heart because they see what they think they see. My mother, bless her sweetheart, is suffering with Alzheimer's, dementia moving forward. And it's so sad to watch. And she'll say, I know what I saw. And she didn't see what she thinks she saw. Hello? And so many times people get deceived by their flesh. And they think, this is the joy. This is the pleasure. This is the answer. I told you about the lady that said to me, I just want to be happy like you. What's wrong with that? Nothing. If you know where you can find that joy and that happiness, that is what God gave me. But you don't find it looking for it. In fact, Luke chapter 8, verse 14, Jesus said that the cares, the riches, and catch this, pleasures of this life are the thorns that choke the word so that it bring forth no fruit to perfection. It's the pleasures, the cares, the riches of this life that causes the seed not to mature. It causes the harvest to be lost. And it causes the loss of God's purpose in our life. We can stuff ourselves with the cares of this life. What was it, Martha? You're so encumbered. But Mary's chosen that good part. I know there's times when we have to do those things which are needful, but that is needful must never take the place of that which is essential. The revelation of joy is to recognize sin's pleasures, sensual enjoyments, are only at best for a season. That's the way we live before God. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1, dead in trespasses and sins, chasing after the pursuit of the pleasures of this world, headed in death to the second death. The joy of the Lord, on the other hand, is as long as you delight yourself in him. Hello? How long you want to be delighted in the Lord? You can always, the Bible said, he will abide with you forever, that he may abide with you forever. He's given to you that he may abide, but he only abides as long as you allow him to. Because the scripture says we have the power to grieve the Spirit. And if we continue to grieve the Spirit, we have the power to quench the Spirit. Literally, put it and its guidance out of our life. Looking for joy, happiness, delight, pleasure, enjoyment, ecstasy, you'll never find God's plan for your life. Never. Not as long as you're looking for the things of this world. What is there? Was an old country song a while back. Talked about looking for love in all the wrong places. Hello. Psalm 16 and 11. Lord, thou wilt show me the path of life, and in thy presence is fullness of joy. You can get drunk. You can get high. You can get caught away in your sexual lust. But in thy presence is fullness of joy. And in sin, whatever I get in the sensual realm is only a seasonal thing. It's temporary. It's going to be lost. But he says, and in thy presence is fullness of joy, and at thy right hand are pleasures that don't ever run out forevermore. Psalms 36 and 8, and thou shalt make them to drink of the river of thy pleasures. For with thee is the fountain of life. In thy light shall we see light. The more time you spend with the Lord, the more you recognize the fountain of life is in his presence. And in his light, you begin to get revelation and illumination and understanding and insight into scripture that before you either bypassed or just was baffled by. And yet in his presence is fullness of joy. We talked about Psalms 1, verses 1 through 3. The blessed man, we talked about his delight is in the law of the Lord. That phrase, his delight, means his prized manner of living. This is his chosen manner of living, is a joyful embracing of God's testimony. If God said it, that's the way it is. Amen. Joy is not life's goal. You can't reach for it and get it, but it's the result of loving and obeying God's word. So, if we want to be like fruit trees, fruitful, we must delight in the word of God. John 15, again, Jesus said, I'm the vine, you're the branches, and every branch in me that beareth not fruit, my Father taketh away. Every branch in me that beareth fruit, my Father pruneth it, that it may bear more fruit. And then finally, he drops down to say, and herein is my Father glorified, that you bear much fruit. So the progression, the love of God that is filled into our heart with the Holy Ghost. The Bible says in Romans 14 and 17 that the kingdom of God is righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. And it starts with the love of God that is poured into our heart with the Holy Ghost. And as long as we let the love of God direct us and mold us and change us, then the joy of the Lord will be there, and it will be our strength. Okay? Word, obedience, love. The goal is loving, trusting, obedience to the Word of God. The result of loving, trusting, obedience to the Word of God is joy unspeakable and full of glory. J-O-Y, J-O-Y. Hello? Jesus first. Love puts it that way. Amen? It does. To live in the Spirit, Paul speaks of in Galatians 5, then walk in the Spirit. And to live and walk in the Spirit is to love God. And to love God is to gladly, whether it seems right or everything seems going backwards, gladly obey the word of the Lord. What saith the Lord? John 15 and 16, you have not chosen me, but I've chosen you and ordained you that you should go and bring forth fruit. That's why you were chosen, that you would go and bring forth fruit, the fruit of the Spirit, also souls that would be won by your testimony. That you would bring forth fruit, and that your fruit should remain. Now, if you desire to have joy, then your goal has to be fruitful. I want to be fruitful. And if I'll be fruitful, joy will take care of itself. I will have that joy. The goal is fruitfulness, spirit, and truth. Fruit, more fruit, much fruit, glorifies the Father. We're taught to pray, Matthew 6 and 9, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. That chapter closes up with verse 33. Jesus said, seek ye first Hello? Seek ye first. Somebody help me. The kingdom of God. That is the dominion of the king. I want him to have absolute authority over me at all times, under all circumstances. The dominion of God and his righteousness. 1 Corinthians 6, 19 and 20 says, you're bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit. And Titus 2, 10 says that we are to live a life so honest that we can adorn the teaching or the doctrine. People will see the life we live, hear the words we speak, and literally fall in love with the message of the Word of God. The goal is always in all things to walk well-pleasing in the sight of the Lord Jesus. Joy, then, is the result. And it can only be a result of only one thing: loving obedience to the Word of God. You cannot walk contrary to the Word of God. Now, you can walk ignorant of the Word of God, doing all that you know to do, and God's joy will minister to you. But as soon as you come up against the Word of the Lord and decide, nope, not going there, you cannot have the joy of the Lord. I know, I've been there. Hello? But when you submit yourself to thus saith the Word of God, then the joy abounds. When you ignore the Word of God, his joy and his strength is lost out of your life. Okay? The peace of God passes all understanding and keeps our hearts in the minds through Christ Jesus. The peace of God is not always the absence of troubles. How many of you are glad for those days you don't have any troubles? They don't make roll call. But the peace of the Lord is that lasting joy. Hello? When troubles come, he can calm the situation, or he can calm you and I in the situation. Our joy is not everything working right. Yeah, we'd like that. But that's not my target. That's the result of my target. I want to please God. Okay? Now, the joy of the Lord is our strength. That means it's the strength of our faith. It's the strength of our fidelity. Happy husbands and wives have a strong, stable marriage. Hello? Unhappy husbands and wives drift from dream world, hello, to questions, to misery. And once they get into misery, unless they can make the turn and discover we're just adults and we're in love, hello, we're going to be friends. I mean, no, you cannot be in love in a marriage if you can't be friends in the marriage. Lovers will kill you. Friends will never. Lovers will commit crimes of passion. Friends never. That's why you go to true love, which is friendship and love. But when you see folks in their misery, they do stupid things. They do anything to snatch a little moment of pleasure or relief. I watch people do that in the kingdom of God. I watch them start off just dreaming that, boy, when I get the Holy Ghost, everything's going to be sunshine and roses. And then the storms come, and the rains fall, and the flood rises, and your house is beat upon and shook. If you don't have a good rock-solid foundation of loving God and believing God and obeying God under you, the house begins to quiver and fall. The next thing you know, people are looking for something out there. Am I making any sense? You don't get joy by seeking happiness. You get joy by seeking the Lord and submitting yourself in all points. Have you noticed how many times I've said submitting yourself in all points, submitting yourself unto the Lord, letting God's word be sovereign, okay? Pursuing personal happiness for yourself. All right, let me back up and say it like it's written. Pursuing personal happiness for themselves. Every cold, every cardinal, every complacent, every worldly Christian and every backslider lost their joy in the Lord. How did they lose it? They weren't focused upon pleasing God. They were pursuing personal happiness for themselves. And joy became the victim of their pursuit of pleasure. The Bible tells us in the last days that deceit is going to be a great thing we have to wrestle against. Don't be deceived. Don't deceive yourself. Don't let anyone else deceive you. Don't let the spirit of Antichrist that's loosed in the world deceive you. But also, there is a distractor. That's not necessarily a deceiver at first. It's just a bait and switch. It's a distractor. It's the love of self and the love of money and the love of pleasure more than the love of God. The joy of the Lord is our strength. And you don't get joy by seeking happiness. You get joy by seeking the Lord and submitting yourself to His Word. Deuteronomy 6 and 4, the Shema. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. Verse 5, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all your heart, soul, and strength. Matthew 22 and 36, Jesus was asked, what's the first and the greatest of all commandments? He quoted that verse. In Mark chapter 12 and verse 28, he was asked again, what is the greatest of all commandments? He quoted that verse, love the Lord with all. And he said, and love your neighbor as yourself. Now the opposite of love is not hate. The opposite of love is covetousness. The opposite of love is self-pleasing. It's selfishness. It's seeking to find your own delight. I know what I want, and I'm going to go after it. All right? The opposite of love is idolizing yourself. Oh, we would never put it in those kind of words. It's deifying yourself. I reserve the right to make the decision. Well, you have the right, but if you want to make the right decision, you'll take it to Jesus and say, Lord, not my will. Come on, help me. Someone said if grass looks greener on the other side, you can be sure the water bill's higher. It's not he that has little that is always consumed, but he that is always consumed with the desire for more who is exceedingly poor. Two ways to be rich. Number one is get all the money you can ever have. Number two is to not want as many things as you do. There was a grave marker I read about that said she died for want of things, and he died trying to give them to her. In 1887, the average American had 70 wants. They could give you 70 things that the average American wanted in 1887. Well, 100 years later, and that's the latest that they have poll. I tried to get one even today. The average American in 1987 had grandchildren that have 500 wants. Who knows how many now? Covetousness is about pleasing self. And one thing is crystal clear, that pleasing self never pleases self. Pleasing God pleases me. Hello? And if you're married, men, pleasing your wife pleases you. And ladies, pleasing your husband pleases you. Boy, that got real quiet. I don't know how, why in the world it did. But pleasing God is the life that's worth living. Because if you'll please God, you'll have the joy of the Lord abounding. Pleasing God is more than just doing right. It's being right. Thou shalt not covet. Keep your life free from the love of money. Be faithful. Be content. Be joyful. Jesus said in John 14, 15, if you love me, the strongest force used to control us in the kingdom of God is, always has been, always will be, love. Later we get to the point, law shows us the standard and reveals to us that in ourselves, we can't reach it. We need a Savior. That's what the law of God does. That's why it's called spiritual. It's good. It shows me what God expects and that it's not in me to do it. But then grace comes along and shows me Jesus. The law becomes the schoolmaster that takes me to Jesus, who is the end of the law for righteousness. He's the fulfillment, the embodiment, the very word manifest in flesh. And his grace is sufficient. According to Romans chapter 8, I have entered into a relationship with him where I am God-led and God-governed and God-controlled and filled with the Spirit of God to the point that joy overflows in my spirit. And the Bible says, what I could not do in the flesh, Jesus Christ came and he has given me the Spirit of life and righteousness, so that now if I will live in the Spirit and walk in the light of the Word, I can fulfill the call of God. I don't have to be down and out. Anybody other than myself ever got down on yourself because you couldn't do all that you thought you should have been able to do? Well, then why don't you look up and smile and say, Lord, I'm cutting you some slack. Fill up the gap. I need a Savior here. Help me. But in the process, help me to stay sweet. Okay? Obeying the commands of Jesus, keeping his words and sayings, because he goes on to say in verse 21 of John 14, he that hath my commandments and keepeth them, it is he that loveth me. Verse 23, if a man love me, he will keep my words. He that loveth me not, keepeth not my sayings. So commandments, words, sayings. The Lord doesn't always have to say, I command you. No, if I just know that's what he wants. Well, you ever heard the old saying, his wish is my command? David, in a time of war, the Philistines had captured Bethlehem. David was in a cave somewhere in a hillside, and he looked out and he said, oh, he remembered in his youth drinking from the cold waters of the well at Bethlehem, and he said, oh, that one would get me a glass or a drink of water from the well at Bethlehem. Unbeknownst to him, his top three mighty men come together, one beside and behind the other. They fought their way through the entire front lines of the Philistine army. Two watched while one drew the water. All three fought their way back. And when they came back into that cave, they said, Sire, here's the water you wanted. David was so overcome with their loyalty that he literally said, I can't drink this. This is the blood of men who jeopardized their life to just take care of a wish that I had. I don't want to be any less faithful to Jesus than those three men were to David. Hello? I want to please him. That's where the joy comes from. He pours it out as an oblation to the Lord. He says, no man should drink this. This is fit only to be given to God as a liquid or poured out sacrifice. But don't you know those three guys was full of joy that they could see such a move on the spirit of their leader? Oh, friend, it fills us with joy to please him. Obeying his commands, keeping his words and his sayings is not optional. If you want to experience the joy of the Lord, if you want to have peace, if you want to have eternal life with him, then keeping his sayings is not an option. Hello? Now, hear me close on this. I had to go back over it and deal with it two or three times before I could get it said like I felt like I wanted to say it. Obedience to Jesus, though never perfect in this life. Anybody ever come short in your efforts to obey the Lord? Has still got to be wholehearted and genuine. I did it with all my heart. I didn't just slough off. I want to please him with everything that's in me. How many know that your best is not always the same? You are in flux. And some days your best is better, and some days your best is less. but it has to be genuinely from the heart. It's the essential part of our faith in Him to keep His word, His commandment, His sayings. It's the reflection of a true love for Him. Love is the only effective motivation for obeying the Lord Jesus. The man said, they asked him how he turned from such a life of debauchery and immorality to live for God. He said, the man on the middle cross loved me into it. He loved me into faith. He loved me into obedience. He loved me into trust. He loved me into salvation. He loved me into serving. He loved me into stewardship. The man on the middle cross loved me into it. And the only people that's ever going to really seek to please God are those who fall in love with Him. Because sooner or later, His way and my way won't be the same way. And I have to say, Lord, I love You. Trying to obey the Lord's command and keep His word without a deep love for Him is what we call legalism. You're following the letter without a true commitment to the Spirit or the purpose behind it. And it only leads to failure. It leads to Phariseeism. It leads to frustration. It leads to dishonesty, because you become dishonest with yourself. You make allowances for yourself that you ought not make, because you're not motivated by the love of God. There's a self-righteousness element there that you have to deal with. So if you love Jesus and you strive consistently to obey His commands, you've got a wonderful promise. He promises grace. Someone has translated grace that never failing love. It's always sufficient. He promises an inner presence. I'll be in you. You'll be in me. Think about that. At the center of my spiritual being is Christ, the anointing of the Lord. And at the circumference, I am sandwiched, Christ within and Christ without. What's there not to be joyful about that? Just keeping your eyes on Him. Jesus said, he that forgiveth most, or he that is forgiven most, loveth most. And he that loveth most, I'll say, has the most stable and strongest walk with God. According to your love for God will be your joy in God and your strength in God. The most joy of the Lord is found in that individual that loves God with all. By faith we experience new birth regeneration from Jesus, the great God and Savior who gave Himself for us. And by faith we enter into and maintain a relationship with Jesus. Tragedy in too many apostolic experiences is that there are people who have experienced, but they have not invested in that experience to develop a relationship. They repented. They were baptized in the name of Jesus. They were filled with the Holy Ghost. They spake with tongues. And yet you see them fall away, some swiftly, some slowly, some steadily, and then later someone abruptly, because you can't see how far they were drifting inwardly before they abruptly broke. You have to maintain your relationship with Jesus by faith. And according, I believe it's Galatians chapter 5 and verse 6, faith worketh by love. It's energized. It's strengthened. How can I believe in a God that I don't love and I don't believe loves me? But how greatly I can trust as long as I know He loves me. And as long as I confess afresh on a daily basis, Lord, I love You. And I purposed in my heart long ago there'd never be a day I would go to bed that I did not wrap up my day by saying, Jesus, among many other things, Jesus, I confess I love You. And I love you because you first loved me. And somebody told me that. Somebody showed me that. How many want to help somebody know that the Lord loves them? And the more unlovable people act, then the more desperately they need to know they're loved. Love isn't approval. Love is an opportunity to be changed. Okay? Moving on. God governed, God led, and filled with the joy of the Lord. Doing those things pleasing in His sight. That's our strength. That's our strength. Psalm 16:5 says, "The Lord is a portion of my inheritance and of my cup. He maintains my lot." Verse 6 says, "The lines are fallen unto me in pleasant places. Yea, I have a goodly heritage." And verse 11, "Thou wilt show me the path of life, and in thy presence is fullness of joy, and at thy right hand there are pleasures forevermore." Joy is simply walking in faithful obedience. And as I walk in faithful obedience, I have peace. I have joy in His presence. I said it last week. Let me review again. Happy Christians don't backslide. The devil's got to steal and sidetrack your joy before you ever grow cold. Something's got to come up. A bruise. Do you ever notice that in chapter 4, verse 18, when Jesus says, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for He has anointed me," He goes to this phrase, to set at liberty them that are bruised. You would think it would be the captive. But it set at liberty them that are bruised. A bruise is merely blood that is accumulated to a impacted area. It's been traumatized. And the blood rushes there to keep deterioration or corruption or infection from spawning in the body at that point. If we're not careful, we can have emotional, mental, social traumas that bruise us so that we can't get away from that bruise. We just can't get past it. But the Lord said He's anointed to set at liberty them that are bruised. Happy Christians don't backslide. Happy Christians don't grow cold. Happy Christians don't go carnal or stagnant or complacent. Happy Christians find that loving and obeying God, they grow, they glow, and the joy of the Lord that remains in them causes their cup of joy to be full and overflowing. So pleasing God is the goal. Joy and peace is the result. If there's genuine love for the Lord, there will be a loving obedience to the Lord. People who love God with all obey God in all. You may have to get another run at it. Your flesh may rise up and you realize, I'm just not going to make it this first step, but I will make it. If there's a loving obedience, there will be, regardless of circumstances and situations, fullness of joy and strength. Happy Christians may fall, but they never fall away. Their joy in the Lord makes them strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Now that's the revelation of joy. Love, obedience equals joy unspeakable and full of glory. Psalms 149 verses 1 through 6 says, "Praise ye the Lord, sing unto the Lord a new song, and His praise in the congregation of saints. Let Israel rejoice in Him that made him. Let the children of Zion be joyful in their king. Let them praise His name in the dance. Let them sing praises unto Him with the timbrel and harp. For the Lord taketh pleasure in His people. He will beautify the meek with salvation. Let the saints be joyful in glory." Amazing. Verse 2 says, "Let the children of Zion be joyful in their king." Verse 5, "Let the saints be joyful in glory. Let them sing aloud upon their beds. Let the high praises of God be in their mouth and a two-edged sword in their hand." 3 John verse 2, the beloved writes, "Beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper. How many believe God wants you to prosper? But when you see that word prosper, don't always see dollar signs. Hello? I mean, just don't. I stand before you tonight with boots that were, well, that's the only expensive thing I bought, and I bought them back in 1989, so that lets you know how cheap they are over the long haul. Pants that I just bought this week for $2.49. A coat that I just bought a couple of months ago for $3.50. A shirt that I bought for, well, I don't think I bought it. I think my wife bought that. But if you go buy and starting at the sole of my feet and work your way all the way to my glasses, you're going to lay out several thousands of dollars. Hello? But God's word says, beloved, I wish above all things. There's nothing I'd rather have happen in your life than that you mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospereth. Every day I live, I pray for every one of you. I'm not saying it because I'm such a great prayer warrior. If you were to hear my prayer, you'd say, you call that praying? Well, I hope the Lord does. But I pray for every family that calls POP their home church. I pray for every member of every family that calls Peoria, Pentecostals of Peoria, their home church. I pray that God will secure you, that He will secure your spirit, your mind, your emotions, your physical health, your financial well-being, that He would secure you. Because I know it's the will of God that we walk in joy, that we walk in peace, because we walk in love. And love is not a warm, fuzzy feeling. Love is, I made up my mind, I'm going to value God above all else. I told someone the other day, I said, when I pray, I'm hesitant to say, Lord, I love you with all my heart, soul, mind, and strength. You that have a handout, the second lesson on your handout says something about joy. Or stewardship is the key of joy. Could I borrow somebody's handout? I've got less than 5 minutes, and I knew I would have. Faithful stewardship is the key to joyful blessings in the kingdom. I've taken 2 weeks to lay a foundation that we love God, obey God, and enjoy abounding joy in God. Now, why have I done that? Because now I'm going to get in your wallet. And you start dealing with people about their money, and all of a sudden, you better have a solid foundation. Because of all things Jesus could have used as a competitor with God, He only used one. He said, no man can serve God and money. The God of this world is money. And it's amazing how much more and more of this world God's people seem to want and seem to just have to have. Hello? Just got to have it. Really? Faithful stewardship is the key to joyful blessings in the kingdom. God said, you bring all the tithe. Now, He's already told him in verse 8 of Malachi, first chapter 3. Will a man rob God? And you say, have we robbed you? He said, in tithe and offerings. And then he goes and he says, you bring it all. You bring all the tithe into the storehouse and see if I won't pour you out a blessing that is so big You cannot contain it. You cannot. God expects His people to show their love and loyalty to Him by giving tithe and offerings to promote His purpose on the earth. Oh, I love you, Jesus. Oh, really? Show me your checkbook. Show me how consistently and how faithfully you have tithed and given offering. Now, I'll go over this in detail next week. So that means you can stay at home. No, Pastor just shook his head. I guess that means we'll all stay at home. Or whatever it means. But I will be back. And in preparing these lessons and praying over it, and I told the Lord, I said, God, I realize on Wednesday night, I am preaching to the choir. You, by and large, are faithful tithers and faithful givers. And me, my nature is, I wouldn't ask you for a nickel, period. I'd trust the ravens to come and feed me. My dad was a preacher hater. I can't tell you how many times he'd say, every preacher ought to be lined up against the wall and shot. And if you didn't shoot them, they ought to be made to get a job and make a living. All they want is your money. They got their hand out. I remember years ago when Brother Don Graham and Brother Vic Murnick wanted Alice and I to pose for a picture out in front of the glass doors and just hold out my hand toward the people that would be possibly coming, that you're welcome. You know, it's going to be a welcoming. And I said, I'll do that, but I want to see the picture first. And the moment I saw that picture, I heard my dad saying, he's always got his hand out. All he wants is your money. I remember telling Brother Vic and Brother Adon, I said, I'm sorry. Either get somebody else to do it or just let's change this whole idea. So finances is not one of those things I love to teach on. But let me run through this with you. Tithe and offering. The tithe was the first and the best of their goods, not the leftovers. Tithing is an external means of showing that the giver understands and accepts that God owns everything. Be surprised how many people think they own it. Number three, in addition to tithe, the Israelites were required to bring various offerings. Number four, in addition to the required offerings, the Israelites could bring free will, that is voluntary, and thanksgiving offerings to the Lord, whatever extra they wanted to give beyond the required tenth. All right? Number five, there's so many times in Old Testament history when God's people selfishly held on to their money or other resources instead of giving them to serve God's purposes as tithes and offerings. And he goes through that. The Old Testament examples of tithes and offerings contain important principles about stewardship, that is, the responsibility of properly managing the resources, money, and other assets that God has given us. They're equally important to New Testament followers of Jesus Christ. Many people who are still plain selfish want to cop the idea that Jesus paid it all and don't cost me nothing. Scripture teaches us an important principle of stewardship. The traditional Protestant Christianity is so askewed with traditional foundation stones that are totally out of kilter with the whole body of scriptural truth that they have come to the place they can dissect salvation, stewardship, service. So that it don't matter. I'm saved if I don't ever do anything right or if I do everything wrong. I'm still saved. That's not scriptural, folks. That's not scriptural. Salvation covers, includes, incorporates our faithful stewardship, our faithful service. In fact, when the devil came to Jesus the third time, he said, if you'll just fall down and worship me, I'll give you all the kingdoms of the world. They're mine to give. And Jesus said, it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God. Notice what else he tied to it. And him only shalt thou serve. Our salvation, our worship, our faith, our fidelity, our walk with God. It's all an integrated part. You can't take the gospel and dissect it and put death here, burial here, and resurrection over yonder and just pick and choose which one you want. Death, burial, and resurrection is the atoning gospel. Hello? Repentance, new birth of water and spirit is the application of that atonement. And we walk with it. All right? Our giving should always be in relation to our income. You can't give what you don't have. Our giving should be voluntary and generous with a willing and thankful attitude. We should not hesitate to give sacrificially when it's not easy to do so. Our giving should be cheerful and not because we feel obligated. If you only give because you feel obligated, now you're under the law. But if you give because you're thankful and appreciative of God's goodness, you're obeying the law of love, the royal law, the law of Christ who gave himself for us. All right? God has promised to reward us according to how we have given to him. And God's financial plan, we don't have the choice to ignore godly principles just because they come to us through the law. The central part of fulfilling the law was the Lord's perfect sacrifice. God's law sets the standards and reveals that in ourselves we cannot attain them. And God's law leads us to our Savior, Jesus Christ, that we may be justified, regenerated, sanctified, glorified. The law sets the standards. Grace enables us in Christ to live them. God still expects us to abide by the ethical and moral principles of his Old Testament law. Read it for yourself. That's why I wrote it. Put it together. But tithing is not just a matter of Old Testament law. To this day, the primary principles of God's word have not changed. In Matthew 23, Jesus condemned the insincere tithing of mint and thyme and etc. But he encouraged the practice when it's accompanied by justice, mercy, and faithfulness. God wants us to give willingly and not out of obligation. Tithe and offerings are still necessary for supporting local church ministries and ministries as well as the outreach missions beyond the local church. Tithe and offerings should not go to outside organization. If you have the means and desire to contribute to other ministries, you should do so through free will offerings above and beyond the tithe and offering you faithfully bring to your local assembly. If all Christians did their part in supporting their local church with the tithe and their offering, our churches would not lack anything they needed. Hello? I can take you in the Bible where the Levites left the temple and worked in the fields because God's people wouldn't bring their tithe and offering. Principle still is real. All right? Some Christians feel they can't afford to give up the 10% of their offering or their income plus an offering. That's when you need to consider how abundant God's plan of giving is. Malachi said, "Will a man rob God? Yet you've robbed me. Wherein? In tithe and offerings." And then God gives them their correcting challenge and promise. "Bring you all the tithe, the whole tenth, into the storehouse, that there may be meat in mine house. And prove me now herewith, saith the Lord of hosts, if I will not open the windows of heaven, pour you out a blessing, that there shall not be room enough to receive." Joyful givers are people who are strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. They have discovered what it means to love him with all. Stand with me. We do not give to God in order to get back more, but he promises that we will. God has not changed. His principles have not changed. The need for ministry support and local church obligations and mission outreach has not changed, but rather it has increased. Everything still belongs to God, and he's still worthy of the honor of our tithe and offerings represent. Never forget the words of the Lord Jesus, how he said, "It is more blessed to give than to receive." But this I say, he which soweth sparingly shall reap also sparingly, and he which soweth bountifully shall reap also bountifully. Every man according as he purposeth in his heart, so let him give, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loveth a cheerful giver. I want to be what God loves. I truly want to be what God loves. God bless you.
He was supposed to be in Chicago next week. He said he's not going, so I guess he will be speaking next Wednesday evening. It is a difficult subject for a minister to speak on. But as a pastor, I tell people consistently, I am a confrontationalist out of necessity. Never been one. Never been a person that sought confrontation. I probably should more often than I do. But as a pastor, I have learned if I get a, while I'm preaching, I know I need to stay there for a while. And I have learned if I hear something from the Word of God through the ministry and I don't like it, I need to go back and listen again. Because the Word of God corrects. And is nothing like finance that causes us to be uneasy. Teaching on finance causes us just to squirm. It's because it's one of the chief adversaries to the true spirit of Christ. And so, I don't judge you. Bishop doesn't judge you. The Word of God is what judges us. And I would much rather be judged by the Word of God here than there. Amen. So come back next weekend and let's find out what the Word of God does. This is not something we've sprung. If you've been here for any length of time, you know I teach every December. I teach on finance. And Bishop said, let me try it from a different perspective this year. I said, yeah. Sure. Have at it. And so I appreciate what he's doing. Thank God Bishop's here. And thank God that you're here. God bless you. Have a Merry Christmas. Those of you that are going to be in town and can make it, I'll see you at 10 o'clock Sunday. God bless you.